Hello. This video is sponsored by Project Terminal. Project Terminal is a work-in-progress first-person parkour game featuring fun and unique movement mechanics such as wall run, climb, vault, and so on. The game mainly focuses on fighting with a knife. Players can choose between long-range fighting stance or close-range fighting stance. Each stance has its unique features and skills, so they should use them according to the situation they find themselves in. Anyways, let's get to the actual devlog. This is going to be my fifth devlog of Project Terminal. In case you didn't get what was going on in the beginning of the video, I figured making a fake sponsor message would be a good and creative way to introduce the game for those who haven't watched my previous devlogs. I'm kind of running out of ideas for the intros. Maybe I don't need to go over them every time now. In my last devlog, I mainly focused on making an introductory map. And in this video, we're gonna go back in time and redo the whole process and make an introductory map again. Because, let's be honest, this looks bad. In all seriousness, the map was wide and there were too many spaces without any specific purpose. While I did clarify in my last devlog that giving freedom to navigate around the map is a good thing, I'm not sure if this also applies to a tutorial map. I believe tutorial maps should be a bit more straightforward, as the main goal of a tutorial map is to teach players how to play the game. And more importantly, the map wasn't made using pro grids, so the buildings weren't snapped properly, meshes overlapped, and the whole map had a lot of bugs. Now that I actually know how to use Pro Builder and Pro Grids properly, or at least I believe so, I made a new map. There were a couple main goals I had while making the map. Number one, movement mechanics should be intuitively explained. In other words, players should acknowledge the mechanics without being directly told. For example, let's have a look at this corner where the player is supposed to learn how to wall run. As you can see, the distance between the player and the platform is further than the player can jump. The right side of the player is blocked, indicating that the player should not try to take that path. If the player looks back, the wall is tilted towards the back, indicating that there is no way there either. Finally, when the player steps back and looks forward, it points to the wall. So naturally, the player would try and wall run. Yet, I'm not 100% sure if this can be perceived by anyone, but there will be a voice guide in the background in the actual game anyway. Number 2. Gradually increasing the difficulty. This is pretty self-explanatory. Harder movement mechanics should come later in the game, whereas simpler and essential movement mechanics should be introduced earlier. Lastly, the map should be easy and fast to go through. I can't bore people in the very beginning of the game and get them stuck. Besides, people usually want to get through the tutorials fast and just get straight into the main gameplay. Something that I'm particularly focusing on for this map is to not add any pauses. Apart from that, there are also some indoor actions, as well as interactive objects, that will make the whole experience more enjoyable. The first floor is mostly about learning the movement mechanics in the game. There is also a second floor, which is primarily supposed to be a place where the player encounters a first enemy and learns combat mechanics. If you've seen my sketch in my older devlog video, you'll notice that there are two buildings, so I made another building. I made a quite empty space here, where players can have fun with their movement mechanics they've just learned. This building is mostly used to master players' movement for the upcoming challenges. If you've seen my community post, you'll notice that I delayed this devlog to finish the map creation. Long story short, it's not done. I did add some lighting and textures to the map for the video, but some things are still missing. In the future videos, I don't think I'll put the map in the main focus of the devlog though. Unless it's a big change, I'm not sure how interesting map developments are. Speaking of lighting and textures, I've added this concrete texture I found online to the map. I originally planned to have default grid textures for the production as well, but they really don't look good. Anyways, I applied the textures, and hold on, what's going on? As you can see, there is a noticeable pattern going on here. The problem is, no matter how seamless your texture is, or no matter how big or small the individual texture tile is, as long as you're tiling them, you will see this repetitive pattern. While there aren't any solutions to completely fix this problem, there are multiple workarounds. I was looking through different solutions, and then I found Unity's official blog post. It's called Procedural Stochastic Texturing, and it's just perfectly what I need. They even made the plugin available for free to download. But one small problem. Last time Unity updated their plugin was 3 years ago. Obviously, there had been a lot of changes to shader graphs since then, so this wasn't compatible with my project. However, I found a Unity forum post discussing about this procedural stochastic texturing, and it turns out there is one awesome developer who made this shader compatible with newer versions of URP and Shader Graph. If you're interested in this shader, the link is in the description. Thanks a lot, Junior DJJR. Anyhow, as soon as I applied the shader, it was like seeing magic. Finally, this seamless texture doesn't seem so bad. Get it? Some movement mechanics lacked animations. As I mentioned in my first devlog, I think animations are quite crucial when it comes to parkour games. Falling down looked quite boring, so I had to get it fixed. The arm stayed in idle position without moving much, and more importantly, when the player hits the ground, there weren't any impact animations. So I made some animations using Unity's animation window and applied them to the player's arms. The player's arms slowly ascends, and after a certain period of time, they start to rotate their arm. This also indicates the player has limited controls in the air. I've disabled things like attack or grappling hooks in this state. Additionally, I've rotated the camera a bit when the player hits the ground. Another movement mechanic that bothered me was wall run. Similar to falling down, the player's arms were also at idle position while they were wall running. It almost seemed like the player was just hovering over the ground while they were stuck on the wall this way. So I added an arm movement animation specific to wall running. Not only that, I've made the camera tilt movement a bit more fancy to really give the impression that the player has begun wall running. Last but not least, I made it so that the player can only climb if they look up. This made more sense in general, and doing this prevented the climbing animations to be odd when the player looked down. Two new movement mechanics have been added. One of the things I've noticed while testing out the map I made was that it was hard for me to control the character on a narrow platform. So I made the player slow down when they were standing on this platform. I've also added a specific animation, which I think looks fine. You might be asking, how do you know if the player is standing on a narrow platform? Oh wait, you're not interested? Hear me out anyway. Here's a top-down view of a narrow platform. Essentially, I'm shooting four lines of raycasts around the player. Whenever two raycasts are hit, that means the player is standing on a narrow platform. No matter which direction the player is facing, if they are standing on a narrow platform, there won't be more than two raycasts reporting something. There's one thing to be careful though. If the player is standing on an edge, there will be two raycasts reporting something, which will report that the player is standing on a narrow platform. So instead, I had to check for two opposite rays. Once that was done, I had an idea to make the player go in a narrow space too. I think this could allow me to make more dramatic openings to the maps. Anyways, here's how it's done. First of all, I needed a way to check if there is a narrow space in front of the player. To do this, I'll shoot two raycasts going left and right, positioned in front of the player. How many raycasts are we shooting? If those two raycasts are both reporting something, then I can calculate the distance of the two points that were hit by the raycasts. This had to be done because we can't let players go through spaces that were too narrow. The rest of the system is a piece of cake. I had to play the animation I made and slow the player down. Pretty much the same thing as walking on the narrow platform system I talked about earlier. That's pretty much it for this devlog video. I did delay this devlog a lot, mostly because making the map took too much time. In my next devlog video, that I'll hopefully make in time, I'll be working on a boss fight to finish the tutorial level. Spoiler alert, it's a stationary boss, so it might not be as exciting as you think it is. I definitely think the combat needs a bit more work as well. For now, I'm actually quite happy with the movement, so combat is my next focus. The problem with combat isn't entirely about me coding the system, but rather, I'm not sure how I could make an enjoyable combat system. If you have any suggestions, please let me know in the comments. This has been Semicoder. I kind of know how to code.